lovely to see so many people. If I hesitate on occasion, it's you'll have to forgive me because my slides. I have done this talk before some time ago with Hugh, but it is a last moment change, so we'll see how it goes. So I went to a talk a while back with Catherine Walter, you know, Michael Swan and Catherine Walter and all those Cambridge English courses and things like this, good grammar book. And she said that in a very nice Texan accent that the root of glamour is grammar, or they share a root in some way. And in a way, I've often thought that is that makes sense because, you know, glamour, you know, it's all about the top people or whatever. And very similarly, grammar is treated in that way in our world. It's the thing which everybody worries about, everybody talks about. You know, you get your student who comes up to you, they want to know, you know, the difference between should, might, could, can, would, do, etc. And you kind of go, well, is this a question? My grammar's terrible. They kind of worry about it. And you kind of think, is this really their problem that of grammar? Or is it something else? And basically, this is the idea of what we will be talking about this evening. What is grammar exactly? And can we approach it in a slightly different way? Well, I think part of the issue as well is that grammar has it's not just in EFL, it's in the wider world that grammar has this kind of highfalutin and high status. I don't know if you know this Toby Young. He's famous for setting up free schools for to teach 6-year-olds Latin, and he's also one of the judges on the Bad Grammar Awards. Okay, and this is one of the texts which received the Bad Grammar Awards. Have a quick look. Does that anything there strike you? You might struggle here to see where the mistakes are. You know, no third person S missing or. You know, misuse of the present perfect. It's quite difficult, but if you kind of, if you look a bit further, you take a bit of kind of thing, a little bit of it out, little account is taken of children's potential interests, that's fine. But then if you continue, little account is taken of that young children need to relate abstract ideas. Okay. And similarly here, there's a mixture of, you know, experience, lives and activity doesn't quite thing. And then they didn't like this one. Much of it demands too much too young. So this is what the judges said about that. Presumably they mean something like demands too much when children are too young to be ready for so much. But as worded, it is simply not English. Young is an adjective and cannot ever be an adverb. Strike us down with lightning. You know, if one wants to be flaunt one's pomposity and, you know, talk in such a way, then yes, perhaps it is ungrammatical. But I think for the rest of us, we will continue to use young as an adverb in the same way as we do when we say they married too young, for example. Or indeed, taking, you know, adapting a song title, do too much too young. If you're of that generation, as I am, and accept it as that's what they're doing here. And anyway, even if you go kind of, you take that kind of view of grammar, that this somehow is, there are, young is only an adjective, will never change, no language will change. Well, we would be speaking the same language as Shakespeare. Oh, no, we'd be speaking the same language as Chaucer. No, we'd be speaking the same language as Beowulf. We'd be speaking the same language as, well, we'd be speaking Latin, perhaps that's what they prefer us to be doing. Or we'd be just grunting. You know, that is kind of what they are saying. And in, curiously enough, when you look at Shakespeare, you have safe, which is never an adverb. It's only ever an adjective, but strangely is used as an adverb there. I think the issue then becomes, What happens if we take this idea of things which essentially are kind of their view, which is kind of grammar? We have our grammar rules and we have these slots. We have words which exist as nouns or adjectives and they fit into their slots. And that kind of, you take that to a kind of extreme and you get something like this. Now, unfortunately, if Hugh was here, he could speak this in his comedy Russian accent, but I'm afraid I can't. This is from a book called Everything is Illuminated. It's the beginning. My legal name is Alexander Perchoff, but all of my many friends dub me Alex, because that is a more flaccid to utter version of my legal name. Mother dubs me Alex, stop spleening me, because I'm always spleening her. If you want to know why I am always spleening her, it is because I am always elsewhere with friends and disseminating so much currency and performing so many things that can spleen a mother. Father used to dub me Shapka for the fur hat I would don, even in the summer month. He ceased dubbing me that because I ordered him to cease dubbing me that. It sounded boyish to me, and I have always thought myself as very potent and generative. Well, in a way, this kind of is almost like an explanation of grammar and what it is and what it's not. Because in a way, we want grammar to be potent and generative ourselves. We want to be able to produce any number of possible, totally creative language. We have our grammar rules and we can say anything with them. But the reality is, we don't. And this is kind of proof of that. In essence, apart from the word spleening, which is a noun and shall never be a verb ever again, it's perfectly correct grammatically. But obviously, it's weird. Why is it weird? Well, the words are wrong, we might say. But why are the words wrong? What is it about them which makes them wrong? And what you realise also, I mean, if you carry on reading the book, you get used to actually how Alex's grammar works and you become kind of understand it quite fluently. Although you don't actually then go on to use it yourself. But we could do, if we all accepted it as the way we would say these things, in the way we would use those words, then that would become correct grammar. That's my view, really. That essentially the grammar is, it comes out of our experience of usage. And then when you look at kind of more, if you like, language mistakes which our students might make, what is the problem? Are they wrong words or wrong grammar? Are you want to travel a lot? Words or grammar? Words, do you. So you go for do you as things rather than, you know, some might say that as do you is a, you know, with a normal verb is the auxiliary. So yeah. Kind of think of it as grammar. Oops, sorry, I don't know what happened there. Yeah, maybe. He put down me for the problem. Syntax. Okay, let's reorder the syntax. He put me down for the problem. Still problematic. So this is, I think this is often what I was talking to you about it the other day, actually. It's kind of this thing that when you're correcting students, we often want to keep part of what they say. We kind of want to follow their grammar. We want to correct the surface of their grammar, which is the wrong thing. This is a split phrasal verb, and with an pronoun, it always has to go in the middle. I understand one thing. I can't get too close to that. That's the problem. But actually, it's more than that. If we were going to say, he bound me for the problem, probably is what they're trying to say. Just a completely different word. She's been banging him for a while. Stative verb, yes, yeah. I love the word stative verb in a non-grammatical kind of way, because what, imagine yourself as a student, how you tell what a stative verb is compared to a non-stative verb. So we could say, she's been seeing him for a while. Essentially, exactly the same kind of concept and meaning. But see is not a stative verb, except when you say, oh, I see you're wearing a tie tonight. Are you going somewhere special? Even though presumably he doesn't wear a tie all day or all time or all year. It's not a state as such. So you imagine, you know, the rules we give so often, and as anybody, I mean, I struggle writing grammar rules. I have to do them often with books. I appreciate, you know, a good grammar kind of explanation, but all of them pretty much are partial at best. And a stative one is a good example of that. Yeah, there's something about states in there, but actually, does that really take us very far? You know, it's the experience of it, which is the how you learn it, essentially. We need to rethink about our policies. Any thoughts on that one? Words or grammar?
Grammar of the words.
Grammar of the words, okay. Good one. We're getting there. I like this. Yeah, so the grammar of the word being here, that we can't use about with rethink. But curiously, despite the fact that we tell students, re just means again, and you just add it to the word think, and it means think again, which is correct. But strangely, we need to think about our policies is perfectly correct, but we need to rethink about our policies is wrong, according to our experience of English. Okay, words or grammar? It's no point trying to convince her. There's no point. Okay, we've got to go for there's no point here. But I mean, why there, not it? We can say there's no good. It's no good trying to. It's no use trying to. There's no need to. But somehow that doesn't, yeah. And they look for shelter because it's storming. Well, perhaps they were experimenting by turning. That's very bad grammatical thing to do, to turn a noun into a verb. Okay, in this case, it doesn't work, perhaps. But why doesn't it work? So this is my basic problem with so much of grammar and words and that kind of splitting off of things, is that it just doesn't work like that. That so much of grammar is dependent on the words you're using, and so many of the words you use depend on certain grammar. And then one of my favorite quotes by Michael, the role of grammar in language courses is often discussed as if grammar were one homogeneous kind of thing. In fact, grammar is an umbrella term for a large number of separate or loosely related language systems, which are so varied in nature that it is pointless to talk as if they should all be approached in the same way. How we integrate the teaching of structure and meaning will depend to a great extent on the particular language items involved. So, I mean, in a way, this is, you ask somebody about whether they're any good at foreign languages, and typically they'll say, oh, my grammar is terrible. And students will say, oh, you know, my grammar is awful. That's what the problem. That's why it's stopping me passing FCE. How many of them say, oh, my vocabulary is terrible? Or how much I don't have enough vocabulary. I don't know how to use my vocabulary well enough. These are not the kind of, they're not just in EFL, as I say, in a way, as we had with the Bad Grammar Awards, I would suggest this is just generally in our cultures, and not just British culture either. It's, you know, anybody's been to Spain, obsessive, Italians, you know, these kind of, it's seen as a kind of our God, if you like. And, you know, to some extent, it's perpetuated because it gives us certain godlike powers in the classroom. We are the arbiters of what is good and bad, and what can go and what can't go. So really, then, we might ask, what are some of these different types of grammar we could be thinking about? Well, one is to think about grammar as types of words and their functions. And the point being here that actually this is very loose in English. The words change their type all the time. So up, you know, can be an adverb, preposition, a verb, an instruction, and probably a noun, I would say, is on the up. So, you know, we can use all of these in different ways. Certainly there are kind of rules, but as I said with the kind of, you know, the continuous and the stative form, these rules are at best partial. So there was I don't know if anybody heard, listens to Radio 4, the Today programme a while back, last week or the week before, there was one on whether they could use less with, like, it was people or something, less people. And they had somebody on saying that basically less has been used with countable nouns for like 1,000 years. You know, it's just, it's commonly used. And essentially it has been, the rule has been created. Presumably because more often we use few. And so, you know, that becomes a kind of rule. And that is often a guide within EFL, which is not something we should abandon altogether, I don't think, but it's just remembering that it is at best a guide. And that unfortunately what happens, as I know from writing, is we often write our examples to fit the rule that we tell them. And you can write, if you write in any kind of naturalistic way, you constantly come, oh wait, that doesn't quite fit. Is that actually an interrupted action for past continuous, or is it a, you know, and you realize that then you have to add in things or change the example so it fits the rule. And that is happening all the time by writers. I'm sure I'm not the only writer who does it. In fact, I know I'm not, because I've seen other people. So, you know, these something to think about. Some are just plain wrong, like the split infinitives, but fortunately we don't worry too much about that in English. Well, we have slots as well. And this is the kind of, this is an exaggeration, but it is based on somebody else's course book. They used to do, I can't remember what they wrote. It was a different verb and noun combination. But if you do it for all the tenses, for pretty much any noun-verb combination, you will find that some just don't make sense. They're just unlikely to be ever said. I drive cars. Well, maybe I drove cars, maybe. I was driving cars. Ah, maybe. Cars were driven. Who by? It becomes slightly... Cars were being driven, and obviously some just we all know are strange. So one thing we could think about is, again, we might use transformations, but being aware of how transformations, filling in our slot is limited. So as an example, if you think of have been, it just have you been, or have you, present perfect question. Probably the vast majority of examples, maybe 80%, there is a kind of actually a theory about this, that 80% are made up of a very few number of words, like 5 or 6 words of the examples. So one thing we might start thinking about, I would suggest, is focusing on those simple words, those few examples, been, known, met, perhaps, I don't know, and explore how they are used within a conversation, more than thinking about, you know, how we can give them, have you slept, have you tried, have you drunk, have you eaten, have you blah, 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 ad nauseam. Syntax and position words, which is an interesting one, just came up. I mean, if you take the example of the one which was the example we had from the bad grammar, they have this, no account was taken, little account was taken. But it's interesting that this is kind of, you know, it goes at the beginning of the sentence and it's kind of connected with a passive. You could think about how where even goes in a sentence and its position. What interested me is actually, I think about this a lot in terms of FCE type of, you know, those closed tests. They are essentially exercises in syntax, but it seems to me that that grammar which is taught there or is tested there is often not taught very much. So there's a lot on, for example, noun phrases, particularly relative pronouns and that kind of relative clauses. If you think at the lower levels, maybe PET and stuff, they'll have auxiliaries, which are missing. But the test is not really, it's not completely a test of meaning and tense. It's a test of knowing that when there's a blank and it's followed by an ing, it's probably going to be a form of the verb to be. But how often do we present that as a to students? I wonder actually maybe that there is a value in that perhaps. We could have, obviously, the thing which dominates our course books and much of our teaching tends to be verb phrases. And again, I'm not saying that we stop teaching these, just that there's a lot more that we could be focusing on and that this tends to dominate too much. And actually, as we'll see a bit later, this comes up all the time, actually, if you are an interactive type of teacher which lets students say things that they want to say, stuff will come up all the time. And you have lots of opportunity just to draw attention to these types of things. So some more lexical ways of thinking about grammar. Well, the first thing which I kind of hinted at is perhaps thinking of lexis as phrases, especially at lower levels. But I think it actually happens at all levels, but it will be stronger at the lower level. So we don't have the example here, but at a higher level, we might kind of think about must. I mean, again, the classic one, which is overtaught in terms of obligation and undertaught in the sense of just a response, that must be good, or that must have been good, which actually is far more common in conversation. But we could just teach that in its first instance as, oh, that must have been good, or that must be good. So we might give them that, and you will find, as I say, if you're having talks, if you're talking with your students, students will often say things like, oh, I think that is good, which isn't quite how we would say it. What I would do is I'd say, oh, yeah. No, I know what you mean. We usually say, that must be good. Okay, and then we just teach it, and they learn that as a kind of phrase. Sometimes I might have a little practice, a little drill, where I will give other things that must be good, and they just reply, oh, that must be good. And you can vary it then, maybe, and saying, oh, that must be bad, I suppose. We could see how we could adapt them slightly. A lot of these, you know, I wouldn't bother if I were you. It's an example of a second conditional. I mean, we do teach those. I mean, it's funny how some of these things, like, would like to, if I were you, we kind of are happy to teach as phrases. It's just that we could do it a lot more, I think. We do it, actually, to some degree, but we could do more. So, you know, you should have told me, again, as a higher level. At the lower level, as I said, I would be teaching have you been to pretty much within their first week of learning a foreign language, rather than waiting possibly the whole of their beginner course and their elementary course till the end on page 150, which is where they usually get the present perfect finally taught. Thank God. Okay. It's just, you know, being flexible. Now, what we're not expecting is to do with our expectations. I'm not expecting a student then to be good at the present perfect in any shape or form, apart from possibly getting have you been to? Correct. But actually, even with that, I wouldn't expect them to get it correct completely, straight away, and all the time. They might say things like, have you been in, or have you been of, for example, or have you be. But the point is, we're enabling conversations here, which we must have at these lower levels, and they want to have, and they need to have. And that's the purpose of those. And then obviously, I think actually they will learn them a bit quicker because they will be hearing them. Those are the language. And if they've been taught it and they have studied, have you been to? I think in hearing it, they will recognize it, and that will be there one step, second step, third step. You know, you need 4 or 5 steps, 7, 12 to make it part of your lexis. Phrases as slots. Yeah, I actually think there is something in slot filling. It's just that we should think of them more as patterns and phrases, perhaps more than a grammar structure, simple grammar structure, which is infinitely available. So, you know, when we first did this talk, we were kind of going to call it, it's grammar, Jim, but not as we know it. And everything you ever wanted to know about grammar, but were afraid to ask, which are obviously just based on films and whatever. There is a term for this we've discovered. It's called snow clouds, I think they're called. And they are very common, actually. We do it a lot. And I actually think possibly when that guy wrote Do Too Much Too Young, he may have been primed by his specials experience. But equally, we could think of... I've started doing this on Instagram, actually, just a kind of little chunk, English grammar chunks. This is my first one, which I did today. It's what are you doing? And then various endings. So again, they're just treating the what are you doing as a kind of phrase, but it is adaptable. So we might have what are you doing now? I mean, if I was in class, it would be what are you doing now? What are you doing after the class? What are you doing later? What are you doing this weekend? Be like 4 very useful ones for them to learn. And, you know, they won't be able to answer. Well, I think you'll find that they manage. They'll say things like, go to the cinema, or just cinema. But to me, that is a step from going... there's a man in the window, he's washing he's doing some ironing, yes. Oh, there's another man in that window, he's playing the guitar. Oh, there's another man in that window and he's whatever. You know, these kind of slightly odd, weird practices of the present continuous, which are never going to be used by the students, and they won't be able to apply them to what they will never get this out of that practice. They will never get what are you doing tonight, because they don't even know that it is possible. So why would they? Yeah, and you know, you could also teach some kind of answers at their level. I don't know. I'm not sure. Nothing planned. I suppose that actually is that could be a present perfect with a bit taken away. Oh dear, yeah. Similarly, you know, there's no pleasing some people. The issue here is that we have to remember always that these slots are limited. So actually, there's no arguing. Angering some people is not quite right. So those are kind of parameters. And there are lots of these kind of phrases we can make use of. And you'll find particularly, again, if students are saying something, it's looking for those opportunities just to show them, A, first what they're trying to say, and then secondly, maybe just giving them 3 or 4 options, not lots, of how they can vary them. Collocation is obviously a kind of grammar. I mean, often it's funny, you look in books, sometimes prepositions are described as grammar and sometimes they're not. You know, there's a whole section in, I think Murphy has several sections on prepositions, which are essentially collocations. It's just that, you know, you're responsible for and then think. And there's lots of it. And again, if we think of our closed tests at FCE and transformations and the other one, the multiple choice, lots of them focus on this kind of grammar. But very often we don't, because we are too focused on, we might teach responsible. Oh, yeah. What do I do?
Go back on, yeah. I think if you just touch it.
Okay. Yeah, it's just that sometimes we teach those individual words. So you might get responsibility as a kind of, you know, word building type of thing. But then maybe we don't recognize that after responsibility, we have a different preposition usually. Okay, so those kind of things could be brought out, and it's seeing words as having grammar and therefore presenting them a lot more with their grammar than we perhaps might do otherwise. Colligation, this is the idea of basically born, so words which go with particular grammar. So I mean, born is nearly always passive, okay? Or bear, I suppose would be the one. Similarly, why was dubbed wrong? He used it in an active form in that alley, in the everything illuminated, but it's much more common as a passive. And that's one of the reasons why it sounds strange, etc. You can think of them in some ways. Again, it's the limits that some of these phrases have. I'm not sure the first two are the best examples, but you know, can't be bothered is a phrase in itself, but it doesn't kind of work. I can be bothered, doesn't quite work. If you take extreme adjectives, which is a kind of colligation that we often teach, or is it really collocation? Does it matter? I don't think so. But basically, you know, we go, very boiling is not possible. It's always absolutely boiling, and there's various ones of these. But if you actually think about it, it goes further than that. So it wasn't too boiling. Are you boiling? It's more boiling than here. It was quite brilliant, correct, and fine, but it was quite boiling? No. So we could actually, with the extreme adjectives, we could kind of actually say a little bit more about them, how they're actually much more restricted even than the absolutely rule. We don't generally use them in questions. We often don't use them in negatives or comparatives and those kind of things. Whether you say all of this in one go, I wouldn't suggest it, but it's being aware of it so that when these issues come up, you can deal with them. And maybe also in giving different type of, you know, if we've taught all these extreme adjectives one day, why don't we look at them in these kind of ways with the other restrictions they have? You know, so we could, have sentences instead of with very and absolutely, we could have ones with two, or as in a question, which ones sound better, which ones are used. So we're kind of deepening their knowledge a little bit about the grammar as you go along. Patterns, which are kind of a bit like those snow cloud things, but not necessarily based on a particular phrase, is always one of our favourites. Just because I'm a teacher doesn't mean. So just because it doesn't mean. Incredibly generative and good for discussion. So you get students to fill in their own versions and you see what comes of it. Quite interesting discussions often. It does happen to be also a special song, so you know, that's always a good thing. And then this one, again, there's some kind of suggestion, this from a video with Nick Ellis, and it's the idea of I think it's also based on Jean Aitchison ideas as well. You have this idea that if you give them, it's mandubled across the floor, that we can guess what mandubled means more or less because it's we're familiar with this pattern of something across the floor is a movement of some kind. So the idea is that basically, again, it's there are quite a lot of these patterns, and learning a lot of them, learning some of them might be useful. And again, the most examples of these patterns are filled with a few relatively small number of words. And so the idea is kind of enabling students a little bit more by showing those, working with those initial patterns. And this would fit with the idea of teaching, for example, have you been to at a low level on its own as a phrase? And then maybe that will enable them again later when we do look at it as a clear pattern of present perfect, how that might enable them a little bit to understand it a bit better and manage it a bit better. And then the last one, I think, was it? I don't know. Discourse is the idea, that grammar goes well beyond sentence level. This is one area which I find very frustrating, is the teaching of linking words like while, however, although, etc., which so often gets, these are showing contrast, these are showing addition, they're all used differently and in different contexts and often in different types of, how many of you have had your students saying, I had a lovely weekend. Moreover, I went to London to enjoy it. It's like, just bonkers. And the same can be true of conversation. There are certain kinds of conversations which progress in similar ways. Where are you from? Typically for us, we would follow that with whereabouts if we know it. And we might ask other questions, very commonly the same ones. So this is certainly something we try and do with our books, at least in the first part, is to at least teach some of these very regular kind of conversations. And from that, you can take the grammar. And then the last thing might be, just think, I won't go into this, the genre dependence, that different genres, different types of writing produce different kind of grammar, different thing. And I actually think that is the reason why that text, the bad grammar, was the bad grammar, because it was a letter to the newspaper. So it'd been edited, almost certainly. And even if it hadn't, it would just be a normal thing to reduce it in that way. So, So classroom implications. The road is long. It's basically grammar is the message, I suppose, ultimately, is it's very idiosyncratic, as are words, that they are dependent on each other, lots of different uses. We're not going to get it in the first go. Meaning is partial for both grammar and words. And we only get to know how they're really used and understand them in their accurate sense over time. So, but we need to start from somewhere. So, it's thinking about whole sentences, using more discourse, using the lexis with the grammar that it's typically used in, thinking about the grammar which the lexis is used with, reading a lot, but also encouraging them to notice, in our classes we do a reading, but, are we noticing, are we getting them to notice just, for example, a lexical set rather than the very frequent words which go with their grammar? Are we noticing any patterns or little chunks which they could reuse? Or are we just looking at it as a sample of conditionals, for example? I think books have lots of language in them, and there is this, all of that type of grammar is there. It's just you have to look a little bit more because it's not often taken. Just an example of that, if you take this would be like It's thinking also about more than the answers. It's, you know, I think I've just written a thing which is the worry I have when I hear people say the book teaches itself. Now, as a writer, in a way, this is what you want teachers to hear, because they think it's easy and it works and it's great. And that's a good thing. But as a teacher trainer or a DOS or whatever, it would fill me with dread, because it seems to me what that suggests is they're not doing anything with the book. They're giving the book, giving the answers, and moving on to the next task. When the whole thing of the teacher, it's the interaction with the material, which is key, which is what makes the lesson both interesting and useful for the student. And if you take that as a, just take this as an example, okay, I've adapted this from a book, an exercise we've got. So we could take this typical kind of thing you see, a sorting exercise where you have these single words. So actually you probably wouldn't get this because they are taken from something which people might say. But let's go, wind and rain, and you have to kind of match them to a word. So we go wind and rain, it goes with blow down, for example. Sun and heat, humid, boiling, mist and fog, lift. Maybe that's it. Well done. So they might, if you imagine the students doing that exercise, they may look up the meanings. They've got the meaning and they match it. But that's it. So then we go on to doing what? Maybe doing a speaking about, you know, talking about weather or experiences of weather. My feeling is what you want, you may not be able to see all of this, is this is how we think of it, but they're not popular because they take up a lot of space in course books. They're text heavy. So there's not enough space for the pictures. It may sound like a joke, but it's true and it's real. This is how it works. And teachers complain about it, it's too text heavy as well. But for me, it gives more. Okay, so basically the same matching type of idea, but in this case, I woke up in the middle of the night because the thunder was so loud and there was this incredible flashes of lightning. It was really scary. And they have to match that to a storm. So basically their processes are the same words are there and there's the same kind of focus on meaning. That's what gives them the answers. But for me, it's what else is there. So first, I woke up in the middle of the night. You know, why did you wake up? You know, why would a storm wake you up? Because you hear the thunder, it was so loud, or whatever. They're seeing other things like, you know, we were driving along the motorway. So we see these examples of our traditional grammar, which we can draw attention to and ask questions about. Or the students can just use as a resource, perhaps, to copy. Almost, you know, practice using them themselves. It still requires a lot of work from the teacher. I'm not, you know, the two require work from the teacher. If I was doing this, the single one, basically I would be wanting to explain, you know, how the word pour down works. I'd want to give an example. And that's putting quite a lot of effort for the teacher to think about all those things. And they probably wouldn't, I probably wouldn't, if I was teaching, it wouldn't come up necessarily with those types of sentences either. But here you can, you know, we could go, I hadn't bought an umbrella. So, you know, why do they use past perfect here? Because it happened before, blah, 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 yeah. So to me, some of it is to do with, is that we can be dealing with grammar more and dealing with the grammar of vocabulary more if we're giving fuller examples. Ideally, the material will help you with that. But if it doesn't, you need to be thinking about some of those examples. It may be that you don't do all of them, you just choose the ones which are the most frequent, the most useful, you think, for your students. Or you might do them lightly in the first instance, But when they do their speaking, you draw attention to those, you focus on those, you give them examples, you support them in as you're going around and talking to them. Those might be the kind of things you go. And other things that might help, explanations. I know that's always add learning rules, may be of some use early on, if we bear in mind that they are just partial. Okay, so I'm talking here like, you know, going to, it means the future. Done. Let's just move on. Let's have a go at practicing it now. They need to know nothing else about it at a low level. That's perfectly enough. It's just a function of there. It's partial. But even if you said, yeah, going to is for intentions, or if you can see something is a present context, well, they won't get that. And well, they won't be able to compare it to will, and they won't be able to compare it to present continuous or any of those things. So yes, explanation, but short, uncomplicated as possible at low levels we're talking about here, and let them have a go, would be my view. Context and listening. So it's kind of rather than the way that is often I see on sometimes in my past when I was doing trainee courses, sometimes you'd see the students there trying to elicit stuff, and it's basically a sentence which they have in their head which nobody else knows. It's not that. When I think about listing, I think of it more in the sense of giving them those chunks and asking for them how they might adapt them. So on an example like that, I might give them, sorry, I'm in a rush. I would say, I've got a meeting I have to go to, or I have to go to a meeting, okay? Any other reasons you might be in a rush? Oh, God. any other reasons you might be in a rush? And that's when, everybody knows reasons you might be in a rush. They won't have the right grammar. And this is the moment where you might kind of correct them. You might point out, you might give a short explanation, or you might just give them the language. So it's up to you a little bit. And then you elicit other things like that. Those, the just because doesn't mean would be another example. You're giving them a framework, you show one or two examples of how it works, and then you elicit other ideas from the students. Noticing, as I said, this is kind of noticing grammar, which is in vocabulary exercises. The problem is that a lot of vocabulary exercises are one words or just words to meaning, matching word to a meaning. And that leaves not enough. But for example, you will see a lot of match words to meaning from a text. And really the thing we need to be doing and encouraging the students is then to go back to the text and look at the grammar of those words and how they might be used. Ideally, if they've been chosen correctly. Again, one way you might be adapting material is, unfortunately, sometimes writers will, for good reason sometimes, they'll focus on those matched words to meanings on being the most obscure words or the most difficult words, rather than the words which maybe students half know but don't know the grammar of, for example. So maybe they know the word boiling, but they haven't noticed properly that it goes with absolutely, for example. So it's those kinds of things which we might draw attention to a bit more in grammar, in texts as well. So obviously at later stages, we might do the kind of inductive learning, thinking about rules, turning rules into questions. Two-way translation, something we've often enjoyed doing. Very possible in multilingual classes. So by this, I might mean, take your exercise, say it's a grammar exercise. What I would suggest is you choose, even in, most grammar exercises will have some examples will be, you'll just go, well, who would ever say that? But there will be examples with things which are very commonly said, could become into a conversation, could be the basis of conversation. You might take that one first, show how that could be manipulated, give a couple of examples. You can ask them to translate. So we take this one, I haven't seen you for ages. They translate into their language. You then wait, cover, ask them to translate it back into English, and then they compare the two. So this is why it works fine in a multilingual class, because what they're doing is comparing what they've written. And they might compare with their other partner about the English they do, and they explain their mistakes that they've made. Obviously works best if there's a little bit of a gap between the two translations. So you could do it as a kind of translate it on the end of the day or just before the break and then redo it. And you can get kind of four or five similar examples that would help them see it. The close exercises, you know, filling, how do you focus on those words like even? Actually, I think even, it works very well with two-way translation as well. But some of these other aspects of word grammar, which perhaps slip through, just blank. What's the missing word? I mean, these are the normal things which we do in exams, but somehow don't get done so much, except when you're doing an exam class. And actually, I think it's almost too late by then. You know, you want to be doing it all the time from the beginning. Drills. So, you know, the example of the must be good. You know, I think of that. We do one on, it always often comes up when you talk about jobs. You know, that must be great. That must be frustrating. That must be interesting. Giving them some little kind of prompts just to drill them, but it's a kind of communicative drill. And then the main thing, I think, is just this offering opportunities for talk and noticing where there are gaps in students' knowledge and trying to correct them, but not just those surface third person S. You've got it's continuous, not simple. You know, trying to really properly reinterpret what they are saying, talking to them, trying to find out what they're trying to say, then getting to our thing, putting it on the board, maybe then expanding on it, asking questions. That is quite difficult. You need practice in doing it. And, you know, I look at sometimes the things I've written down for students and I go, God, that's not very good. But I think it's the will to do it is takes you some way, and students appreciate it because they're being attended to and being told things that they want to say. So that is a very kind of key part of everything. And then I'm going to pass on that because we don't. This was my my advice from after what's his name? I've forgotten. Philip Larkin. Yeah, they fuck you up. Your mum and dad is usually what it is. They fuck you up, your language teachers. They don't mean to, but they do. They plague you with their rules of grammar with extra homework just for you. They were fucked up in their terms by fools in old-style hats and coats who half the time had games and fun and half Murphy'd you round the throat. Man hands on misery to man, it deepens like a coastal shelf. Get out as early as you can and don't obsess about grammar yourself. There you go, and that's it. Thank you. Welcome to have questions. I think the PowerPoint will be made available. If you don't get it, you can contact me on andrew@lexicallab.com. And, oh God, yeah. And then the other thing is, oh dear.
There.
Oh, there you go. There you go. I have to say we haven't been using this quite so often recently because we've got another project on the go at the moment. But you can also find us at this one. You might. Oops. We're doing this word of the day blog. I don't know if anybody's seen it at all. It's just kind of, word which either came up in class or sometimes it's a little chunk. It's a little kind of text about it, a few questions. They're very usable in class, I hope. That's the idea behind them. Catch us on Facebook, all that, I think. And if you're interested in some of the things, we have got our new methodology book, Teaching Lexically, which goes into a little bit more detail about some of these issues.
Okay.
That's it, yeah.
Michael
questions.
Seems to have disappeared somewhere. People have to be out of the building by 8 o'clock, so there are more nibbles and wine and questions.
Questions, yeah.
So help yourselves to nibbles and wine, and then 8 o'clock I will have to ask people to leave. Okay? I'm about to kick you out.
Are there any questions now before we...
I have one question.
Yeah.
How do you reconcile level with description and prescription?
Description. How do I reconcile level with prescription and description? I think the point with me for level is that you really follow simple chunks at the lower level. So there's a kind of prescription that certain...
Well, at what point do you break off from prescription?
I'm not sure what you mean by, like...
Because the idea that you are... The grammar, in the end, at higher levels has no rules. I mean, I'm loving your presentation.
Yeah.
That's not a state of...
Yes. I see what you mean. Okay.
So if you can't give rules to lower levels, how can they feel confident in moving forward?
I think the first thing is, at lower levels, you can give a rule. It's just very, very basic. Okay.
You're not telling them the truth, are you?
Because they can't get the truth. Yeah, no. No, you're not.
What I'm saying is you have to create but the foundation on which to break down what you have created.
But there will be no... Well, you're not... Say if we take, for example, the going to is for the future. Yeah, that is a foundation and it's true. There is nothing to be knocked down there. What they won't get is how all the other futures work. And I think that's where we get kind of lost on sometimes. It's this kind of trying to differentiate everything between the different kind of grammar rules that we give, which are partial at best and partially understood at best. And that they will only get that accuracy through a lot of exposure over time. And we can start dripping in. I don't actually disagree with then showing them the different examples of will and going to, that will we more often use on those spontaneous moments, and we give examples of those. But again, we're just being clear to ourselves more than anything, actually, that these are difficult and will not be got. And I think, to me, it's actually much more about what the teacher worries about than the students. Students are just trying to make their meanings most of the time. So I think it's not then they get it wrong, they haven't got the rule, they haven't got the difference, and then trying to bang on about it again, because that's just not going to work and it will take a lot of time. So as you go along at the higher levels, obviously the rules become, as you say, much more about just description of how these words work, really. And then it becomes, you know, there's not a huge amount to say on grammar at all, to be honest, in a way, in my view.
You mentioned that, for example, present perfect is mostly used with about 5 or 6.
Yeah, I mean,
verbs,
yeah.
Or 80% of the usage is those. Where would we'd be able to find that sort of information and which verbs there might be. I guess it's an
research. Yeah, I mean, part of this goes on the basis of this research by Nick Ellis. He has this, there's a website, Nick Ellis, you can see on YouTube, he talks about it. He talks about Zipf's law. And it's this, it's a kind of power relation that the 80% is... is a thing, and it works in lots of different scenarios and different, you know, incomes and things like that. It works in the same way. In terms of, so I think the first information is from your own knowledge. You know, really, don't you? I mean, which are the most common ones, which you probably use most often. There are also that, I think the Longman Grammar of Spoken and Written Language also had, it's a big fat, I think it's quirk, I don't know, is it? Longman Dictionary of Spoken and Written Grammar, or Longman Grammar of Written and Spoken Language. I think it is quirk and
Greenberg.
Yeah. And they have some statistics on these things, on usages and stuff like that as well. Although it is based on the first corpora. So maybe, you know, again, maybe it's been updated, it could be updated now.
How much do you think you had to compromise your last textbook with your lexical
approach? Well,
because the publishers are quite
They are. And yes, well, we have to follow more or less. So if you look at, for example, Innovations Elementary, we have, you know, going to in Unit 4 or something like that. Having been to, I went to this conference once, and somebody was looking at the book, and I was just kind of going to sidle over and say, oh, no, I'm the author. And she opened it, and she goes, oh, going to Unit 4, too difficult, and closed it, and walked off before I even got anywhere near the stand. So, you know, I think the issue for me is I have, you know, publishers are very conservative, but you have to remember they are taking their lead from teachers often. And so we have to adapt to that to some extent. So if you take like our elementary course book now, we had to compromise in the sense that we follow present simple first, and then there's... I can't remember what comes next, but we go slightly faster than other course books in terms of developing. Like, we introduce past simple in Unit 4, I think. 3 or 4, I can't remember. Just because it allows you then to use the past simple. because that's the thing, you know, these books are not just restricting it being taught, they're not showing it. They don't actually see any examples of it, so that it's that's also where you can push the envelope a bit. We also, for example, in Unit 2, we ask them to arrange to meet somebody, but we do it through, do you want to meet later? Do you want to? Where do you want to go? So basically, they're talking about the future, but it's using present simple form. And then, if they were in my class, you would imagine they will try and start saying other things about the future, and you can, these are moments where you can feed in some of these things. And then I think the last thing is we manage still to have some topics which you don't necessarily always associate with elementary course books. So, for example, we have one on talking about policies, education, social policy, it's going to cause unemployment. So this is future. This is our kind of practice of the future. It's going to cause unemployment. It's going to create jobs. It's going to cause pollution. I can't remember what exactly. Now, these words are among the most common in the English language. Cause is far, far more common than living room, for example. But we never teach that. They just don't get taught at elementary courses because they're seen as somehow difficult, or they'll lead to difficult conversations. But if what happens in you'll find is the students, that's what they talk about normally. That's what they want to try and talk about. They have a go and you help them, or they just do the best they can and they exchange some thoughts and feelings and you move on. Usually without getting them going too correctly, you know, because they're elementary students and I don't expect it. And again, it's that thing, it's the expectation of the teacher and looking for the opportunities. which, you know, we write those kinds of questions sometimes, which we know will generate, we hope will generate some discussion, and with a good teacher will exploit them and help the students, and that will give you opportunities. Affordances, I believe, are the technical term these days. We like to look for those in our material. So, yeah, bit of compromise, but, you know, we try. Keep the fight going. Yeah. Wine, I think, is needed, perhaps. Yeah, cheers.